Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome you here on behalf of the Arlington Hospital Foundation and the Steering Committee for the Dolan Lecture Series. Steering Committee, Dr. Don Nolan, Dr. Larry Gatos, Dr. Ryan, and himself, Dr. Dolan. Special thanks to, you know, when somebody comes up with a brilliant idea, you have to recognize them. And Dr. Russ Stay came up with the brilliant idea of Dr. Bonadonna. And Russ, thank you for steering the steering committee in the right direction. This is the fifth annual Dolan Lecture. And the Most Reverend John R. Keating, the Bishop of the Diocese of Arlington, is here with us, a personal friend of the Dolan family, to give us an invocation. Bishop Keating.
Let us pray. Almighty God and Father of us all, we, your servants, pause to ask your blessing upon those who have dedicated their lives to the noble and godly work of healing us, both in body and in spirit. Inspire and encourage those whose vocation is to heal, to save, and to restore. Give them wisdom and purpose in the myriad tasks they perform, from the lonely frustration of research to the splendid exhilaration of health restored. Father, extend your blessing also to the patients now present in this hospital. May they know the consolation of your friendship and the joy of recovery, so that their lives might all the more proclaim your goodness, and their voices sing your praises. Finally, Father, bless those who have made possible the special event of this evening. May their work redound to your honor and glory. Amen.
Thank you, Bishop Keating. We will meet at the Hazel Conference Center is a frequently heard phrase used in our community for the past 10 years. And I have going to take a couple of minutes to welcome Jinx and Till Hazel, who are here with us. It is the Hazel Conference Center that is the result of the Hazel Boys, Bill, Till, and Doug, coming to us at the foundation about 11 years ago and said they wanted to do something to honor their dad. For those of you who are not familiar with the history, Dr. Hazel performed the first surgical procedure at the Arlington Hospital when it first opened. He was the chief of surgery here at Arlington longer than anyone else served in that position. A wonderful gentleman, a leader in the community, and witnessed the family he rose, he brought up a great tribute to him. They came and said, we want to do something to our dad to be honored, and what do you need? And we sat together and said, well, what we really need at Arlington, probably more than anything else at this time, is we need a place where teaching can go on, where conferences can be held. The affiliation bringing students, residents, interns to here, to this institution from Georgetown, and they literally were meeting in the hall in empty patient rooms. So the very generous Hazel family said, well, here's some money, and a sizable bit of money, and let's see what we can do about putting something up as a conference center. And this is the result of that effort. The Hazels were extremely generous, and other people in the community joined forces, and this is what we have, and it's wonderful. It's used all the time, not only for teaching purposes, but the community uses it, and it brings the community closer to this hospital. Dr. Hazel, unfortunately, is no longer with us, but I'd like to, for a minute, to share a little something about Dr. Hazel. In 1982, when we dedicated this edifice, we had a really very warming program, and one of the gentlemen who spoke was a classmate of Dr. Hazel's, from Georgetown University Medical School, class of 1928. Now, Dr. Hazel, in addition to his great strides in medicine, we got our heads together and recognizing the history of this man in this community, he was extremely interested in education, medical education. He was there at the conception, the birth, and nurtured the Georgetown affiliation for all these many 45 years or more. And so we decided something along with medical education would be a thing. So that out of that grew the Dolan Lecture Series. Raising money for this purpose was the easiest money that I've ever been involved in raising, and I asked Judy and she agreed. Everyone we went to had a different story about this fine gentleman, what he meant to them, to their family. Stories of late night driving over to the emergency room, helping them in their bereavement, helping them when someone was very ill. Time and time again, we got these great tales of this fellow, and it all came out that above all, he was a physician worthy of the name. And so this is how the Dolan Lecture Series came about. This is the fifth annual. We've had, if those of you haven't been here, we've had Dr. Tony Fauci, we've had Dr. Denton Cooley, William Roberts, and George Lundberg. Tonight continues that trend of world-famous speakers. And at this point, I would like to introduce Jim Rita, President and CEO of the Foundation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ken. It is indeed an honor for me to welcome all of you to the fifth annual William D. Dolan Lecture. Bill is as close to the heart of the Arlington Hospital as one can get. He has been here almost since the day the hospital opened its doors. His commitment to this institution, our patients, and our medical staff has been a driving force in the growth and success of this hospital. We are working very hard to ensure that Bill Dolan's tradition of setting the highest standards of excellence at the Arlington Hospital continues. We all want the best facilities, state-of-the-art equipment, and most professional service possible. We will face very challenging times in this coming year. No one can be sure what challenging and what changing regulations lie ahead, particularly with the new administration coming in across the river, and how they will very much impact physicians and hospitals. The only thing we can really be sure of is that change is inevitable. Maintaining our standards of excellence in patient care will require a real commitment from everyone involved in this hospital today. We have a very proud tradition of the cooperation and teamwork involving the medical staff, administration, and the members of our boards. I have seen it displayed many, many times here in the last few months. We have made hard decisions and compromises in our budgeting processes. We have and will continue to work together to address the special challenges of managed care, which is a very new thing for all of us in this industry. We will strive for excellence in the spirit of cooperation as the year goes forward because our ultimate concern is patient care. Nothing is more critical to patient care than the education of our physicians. And thanks to the generosity of those of you who created this endowment, we are able to honor Bill Dolan by bringing an outstanding speaker to further the education of the Arlington Hospital medical staff each year. So without any further delay, let me ask the president of the medical staff, Dr. Robert Ryan, to come on up here to the podium to introduce our lecture for the evening. Bob?
Before I introduce the speaker, I want to tell you it's a great pleasure to be here on behalf of the medical staff. I want to tell you a story of fear. When I came here as a medical student more than 30 years ago, it soon became apparent Dr. Dolan was the driving force, a very demanding person. I lived in fear of him as a medical student. I came back as a resident I still was in fear of Dr. Dolan. I finally came here as an attending. I'm still afraid of him. Finally, I got elected the president of the medical staff. I figured, well, this does it. But I'm still afraid of him. Now, I felt real good when I was elected by the 800 doctors about 5 years ago. And one of our first guest speakers was coming in. And they introduced me. I was the president of the medical staff. He said, oh, good. But now I want to see the real power, Dr. Dolan. And that's the way it's been, and that's the way it's going to be. Dr. Dolan has had a knack for surrounding himself with intellectuals who are seeking answers, state-of-the-art knowledge, bringing this information here to Arlington Hospital. And it's been an outstanding record. I don't know if we can beat it. We'll still try, but every year we get speakers in here, nationally famous, and then tonight we are going to hear a man who's internationally famous. But I do want to say to Dr. Dolan that with gratitude and love on the part of the medical staff, we are great admirers of him, and he has helped lead the way for all of us. Now, it's an honor for me to be here, of course, to introduce the speaker, whose topic tonight is of great concern to everyone here. Our patients, our mothers, daughters, wives, friends are all faced with the increasing likelihood that they'll develop breast cancer in their lifetime. And as you know, statistics tell us 1 in 9 are likely to meet this challenge. But thanks to the outstanding research being done by many people in the country and elsewhere, but in particular, Dr. Gianni Bonadonna, the prospects for women living with breast cancer have greatly improved. Dr. Bonadonna is a graduate of the University of Milan, received postdoctoral training at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, and since 1976, he has been the director of the Division of Medical Oncology at the Milan Cancer Institute. So I'll make no attempt to introduce him in Italian, since I really will have trouble with that. But it's a great honor for all of us to be here tonight and to hear what he has to tell us. And so without further ado, I will tell you his topic is going to be the evolving concepts in the systemic adjuvant treatment of breast cancer. Dr. Bonadonna.
Let me put on, ladies and gentlemen, all the necessary instruments. Look more like a successful movie actor or successful politician. They all need these kind of things. Mr. Hagerty, Reverend. Dr. William Dolan. I try to do my best to illustrate in a rather simple way the evolving concepts in the systemic adjuvant treatment of breast cancer. Since I'm getting old, let me start with a simple sentence. The whole adventure of systemic adjuvant therapy of breast cancer began not too far from this center, actually at the National Cancer Institute approximately 20 years ago, when Dr. Bernard Fischer started first designing the first modern trial with adjuvant systemic therapy. I followed approximately 6 months later because of Dr. Paul Carbone, at that time the director of medical oncology at the NCI, has introduced me into the problems of adjuvant chemotherapy, and I was fortunate enough to elect combination chemotherapy rather than single agent chemotherapy. Chemotherapy at that time consisted of 3 drugs I'm going to talk about, now known as the acronym CMF, cyclophosphamide, methotrexate, and fluorouracil. Again, as an introductory slide, we can call, actually, this is one of the slides I took from a recent Dr. Bernard Fischer's paper. paradigms which govern breast cancer management. The old one, still in vogue approximately 20 years ago, was designed by Dr. Holsted about a century ago. Dr. Holsted stated that there was the anatomic and mechanistic basis for cancer surgery, and he designed the famous Holsted radical mastectomy, which included the unblocked dissection of axillary lymph nodes. Later on, Bernard Fischer himself, with his brother, designed or proposed the biological paradigm, which essentially included the early spread through the blood vessels, and lymph nodes were only indicators and not necessarily the instigators of micrometastatic disease. Approximately during the same years, Dr. Howard Skipper from this country proposed the pharmacological paradigm. Micrometastases are more vulnerable to drugs than primary cancer. So armed with these concepts, we started eroding the Holstedian paradigm. This included, within a few years, the concepts of conservative surgery plus or minus postoperative irradiation, the adjuvant systemic therapy, the concept of tumor heterogeneity, and the concept of tumor burden, cell resistance, and dose intensity, which remains today probably one of the still not completely discovered concepts, but very important from the prognostic point of view. Last but not least, I will talk about primary chemotherapy. This is a prognosis of breast cancer with local regional therapy alone, so surgery plus or minus postoperative irradiation. You see that when we are dealing with positive nodes, more numerous are the nodes, worse is going to be prognosis within 10 years. When no histopathological involvement of nodes is present, prognosis looks good, but it's not exactly like this. Approximately 1 out of 4 women are going to have a disease relapse in spite of optimal local regional control. This is the graph of our first paper, which was published in 1976 in the New England Journal of Medicine. We prospectively randomized approximately 400 women with positive axillary nodes. This was surgery alone at that time, was a classical radical mastectomy designed by Holsted. And this was mastectomy followed by CMF. There was an enormous interest in those data, which are still holding up, so the curve is a little bit different, about close to 18 years now from the beginning of those studies. You see the consistency of the CMF chemotherapy we have performed in our own institute, and this is the so-called control group, or surgery alone. There were two consequences, very important. The first one was that CMF or similar type of regimens changed the treatment strategy. That was rather quick. Not that everyone was convinced, but most people, including general practitioners, changed the treatment. And this opened the way to a number of new studies, such as studies on treatment intensity and duration, non-cross-resistant regimens, feasibility of radiation therapy concomitantly with chemotherapy, continuous redefinition of prognostic factors, chemotherapy plus hormones or versus hormones, delayed morbidity, and also the socioeconomic impact. The other important consequence, I express it in an Italian way. You know the personage, and we can say that this is the surgeon and this is the radiation therapist. They were constantly flogging the poor chemotherapist because he was, or her, was accomplishing nothing. But from that time on, everyone gained the impression that also the clinical data were important within the research area. About the beginning of this year, there was the so-called validation of all these initial individual experimental data performed all over the world through what we have called the international overview. The data were put together by reputable statisticians in Oxford. There was a large group of patients treated with surgery alone, and the large group of women treated with either postoperative chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy, or postoperative adjuvant endocrine treatment. So the 10-year results based on 77,000 women, a large series all over the world, the 10-year results were essentially confirming the 5-year results which were published about 5 years ago. The cumulative difference in survival was larger at 10 than at 5 years, so it was even more promising. And tamoxifen, an endocrine agent, produced a highly significant mortality reduction during the first 5 years and an additional mortality reduction also during the next 5 years. Other findings included the importance or the relative importance of the estrogen receptor poor subsets. The mortality reduction was much more prominent in the presence of estrogen receptor positive humans and in patients with less than 5 years, also ovarian ablation in that particular overview became important. It was important many years ago, but felt not to be terribly practical. But what counts is that also endocrine treatment became important from the clinical point of view. These are the data in terms of recurrence, death in women less than 50 years, roughly the premenopausal, or more than 50 years, roughly the postmenopausal women. So without going into many details, we can see that the polychemotherapy, combination chemotherapy versus control, had the annual reduction death in recurrence of 37% and 27% in death in premenopausal women, 22% and 14% in postmenopausal women. So as we always said, it was not true that chemotherapy was effective only in younger women. It's going to be effective also in postmenopausal women, provided, as I will show you in a few minutes, the dose rate remains high. Tamoxifen is important particularly in postmenopausal women, 30% reduction in the annual odds of recurrence, 30% and 19% reduction in death. There is an evidence that chemotherapy plus tamoxifen versus tamoxifen is yielding better results than tamoxifen alone. What I have shown is called meta-analysis. I'm going to spend only a few words to stress that meta-analyses are important for validating the data, but they do not represent the state of the art. The reason is rather simple. Meta-analyses are often controversial, sometimes surprises in terms of results they yield, and always difficult to digest, particularly for clinical people. But clinical people do remain important to treat the patient. So despite some stormy reactions and interpretative difficulties, meta-analyses are here to stay. It's our own duty to pay attention to some of the data and try to see what's coming out and try to make things simple from the clinical point of view. Now, at this point in time, there was a long battle between chemotherapy versus tamoxifen, for instance. Tamoxifen is very easy to administer. It's devoid of most of the side effects associated with chemotherapy, so it's very much preferred first by the surgeons, then by clinicians, medical oncologists, and last by the patient. Now, at this point in time, what we are going to do? Is adjuvant endocrine therapy effective? The answer is yes. Is adjuvant polychemotherapy effective? The answer is equally yes. Now, how can we improve current results to make these two modality partners rather than competitors? So I foresee in future to start treatment with chemotherapy, let's say for about 6 months, and I will explain you why later on, to be followed by long-term tamoxifen. By long-term, I mean something more than 3 consecutive years. Does the above-mentioned overview provide adequate measure of what practicing physicians can expect from adjuvant therapy? My own opinion, as far as endocrine therapy is concerned, the answer is yes. Treatment was simple, 1 or 2 pills a day, and was rather uniform throughout all the studies. As far as combination chemotherapy is concerned, my own opinion is no. There is an heterogeneous group of treatments delivered through various drugs, doses, and intensity. And if chemotherapy is not delivered with the proper dose intensity utilizing the most effective drugs, then you have a bunch of data which is probably not going to represent what you can actually obtain in a clinical setting. For instance, the above-mentioned overview could not take into consideration the dose, and particularly the dose rate. This graph comes from one of my early papers. Exactly, this was published in the New England Journal in 1981, and stressed the importance of the dose. Patient receiving the optimal dose had their best results. Patient receiving low-dose chemotherapy for a number of reasons had practically no superior results versus control at 5 years. Intermediate doses were intermediate in terms of findings. The data were confirmed at 10 years. And then a Canadian investigator, Dr. Hriniak, developed the concept of dose rate in terms of dose intensity expressed in milligrams per meter square per unit time. And so he was able, by looking retrospectively a number of results, to produce what we would call a dose response curve. And this made clear that also postmenopausal women could indeed benefit from chemotherapy if the proper dose intensity could be administered. This happened to be the postmenopausal women from our own study. We all together, they apparently had no benefit from adjuvant chemotherapy in our own first study, not in subsequent ones. Only this year, because the previous studies were dealing with retrospective evaluation, only this year we were able to see a study, prospective, made in the United States, dealing with 1,572 patients treated with cyclophosphamide, adriamycin, and 5-fluorouracil. This was stage 2, so patients with node positive. The 3-year relapse-free survival yielded very simple results. With high dose, 75%, with moderate dose, 70%, with low dose, CAF, 64%. And there was no difference between pre- and postmenopausal women. So this is not the final proof. There's nothing impeccable also in this study. But this was the first time a large body of physicians could recognize that our own retrospective studies did tell the truth. The dose remains important. Another concept which could not be taken into proper consideration in the meta-analysis is the societal aspects, what we would call diverse cell populations. So we are dealing, when we talk about neoplastic disease, and in particular about breast cancer, that a single patient may have indeed many diseases. So the cell sublines are numerous. We don't know how many. And certainly the most dangerous are those which are resistant to our own drugs before being exposed to the action. In a second study we performed in Milano, we found that 12 cycles of CMF, equal to approximately 12 months, could be challenged by the administration of the same regimen given for 6 months. This would be an advantage both for the patients and for physicians, which means in a theoretical way, this is a famous graph from Dr. Howard Skipper I mentioned before, that chemotherapy before drug-sensitive cells kills those cells very rapidly, and the failure comes up or comes out only by largely drug-resistant cells. So there is no reason to continue with the same drug regimen beyond a given period of time. No one knows which is the optimal time to give the primary chemotherapy or the first drug regimen, but approximately it's in the range of 4 to 6 months. This prompted a number of studies from our own institute to exploit the use of adriamycin. We set up in women with 1 to 3 nodes, approximately 400 patients, a prospective randomized study. We gave intravenous CMF versus intravenous CMF followed by adriamycin. As you can see, we failed to achieve superior results utilizing this type of sequential treatment. And this was true in premenopausal and postmenopausal women. And please pay attention that the slope of the curve is exactly the same regardless of menopausal status. In a concomitant study in women with more than 3 positive axillary nodes at histopathology, we randomized adriamycin first, followed by CMF, so the opposite sequence as previously mentioned, versus the alternation of CMF with adriamycin. Another large series of patients, and the results, which were presented this year at the ASCO meeting, the 6-year findings definitely indicate that adriamycin followed by CMF is superior not only to CMF followed by adriamycin, but the alternation of the two regimen. And this is the relapse-free survival at 6 years. Also, total survival confirms this finding. This is the patient, the subset from 4 to 10 nodes. And this is the terrible subset, terrible in terms of prognosis, with more than 10 axillary nodes. Still, there is a difference in favor of adriamycin followed by CMF. So there is ample room in the future for further investigation from both laboratory and clinical point of view, which is going to be the optimal sequence, and how to integrate the anthracycline. There are several anthracyclines, but so far adriamycin remains probably the best. How can we expand our knowledge at the clinical level, trying to find the best non-cross-resistant regimen? Now let's talk about prognostic factors. There were many prognostic factors put before the eyes of clinicians. To make the long story short, they are established prognostic factors. See the old one: tumor size and grade, number of involved axillary nodes, then the steroid receptor status, and tumor cell proliferative activity. These are the established ones. Clinicians are still making decision whether to give chemotherapy or not give chemotherapy on the basis of these prognostic factors. Then we have a deluge of additional prognostic factors. But in my own opinion, and not only in my own opinion, they do require additional investigation. DNA ploidy, oncogene of expression, gene amplification, epidermal growth factor, protease, cathepsin D. In the meantime, we found that we do have 2 additional important prognostic factors. the dose of chemotherapy. Low-dose chemotherapy is a poor prognostic factor. And the same is short-term adjuvant tamoxifen. Now, what should we do in women with node-negative breast cancer? One out of four is going to relapse. How should we select those patients? We are not supposed to utilize chemotherapy or even tamoxifen as a panacea. It would be the end of medicine. Doctors are supposed to select their patients based on solid prognostic factors. Now, as I mentioned before, we have a new constellation of prognostic variables. Doctors are confused, but also research people are unable to confirm each other for a number of technical reasons. From the papers, from scientific papers, we find that too many independent variables, too many significant positive results, in a few words, too many conflicting data. This is not to discourage what people are doing in the laboratory, particularly when in connection with the clinical people. But for the time being, we do not have solid biological prognostic factors to select patients to help us deciding whether we have to give chemotherapy or a given type of chemotherapy versus hormonal treatment. So node negative cancer, to treat or not to treat, this has been a long battle all over the world, but particularly in the United States. Still, doctors have to decide also because the patients, the ladies, are getting more demanding, also from this point of view. They want to be treated. What was a good prognosis for a doctor, 75% relapse-free survival, was a horrible prognosis for a patient, and the patients were right. Roughly from a simple point of view, we have the so-called low risk, probably less than 10% chance to have a recurrence, probably, but not all investigators do agree. Very differentiated type of tumors, such as tubular or papillary or medullary. Tumors less than 1 centimeter in diameter, nuclear grade 1, low proliferative rate. The opposite is called high risk, more than 10% chance or more than 15% chance of having relapse after optimal local regional control. Tumor more than 3 centimeters in diameter, aneuploid tumors, no estrogen receptors, high proliferative rate, and high cathepsin D. Nothing is so clear-cut, but we do have to take a decision. These are our own data, which are now evaluable at 10 years. Surgery alone was given in women who were operable but had the estrogen receptor tumor negative. And this was a prospective randomized study. This is the relapse-free survival at 10 years. You don't need many comments to find out how chemotherapy was successful. And all these women achieved this finding by receiving the optimal dose. So we were very close to 100% of the delivered dose. And this is total survival of the entire series. So definitely, TMF or similar kind of treatments can be very effective in properly selected high-risk women. This table is rather complicated, but besides the Milan group, also the large NSABP study and the intergroups, they simply confirm the data. They utilize approximately the same drug regimen and actually confirmed the initial data. If we properly select the patient to the best of our knowledge and we give full-dose chemotherapy, there is a reason to treat selected node-negative women. Also with endocrine treatment, namely tamoxifen, there were 3 large studies in Great Britain, in Scotland, and this is United States, showing that in postmenopausal women and also pre and post, having the estrogen receptor status positive primarily in the United States, but the assay was not required in Europe, there was an advantage in favor of women receiving tamoxifen in terms of relapse-free survival. Although total survival was, the difference was not convincing enough, at least for the time being. We definitely need additional data from this point of view. There's always a price of success. What about late side effects? Delay side effects terrorize the doctors much before the patients. For chemotherapy was something rather violent, because it's supposed to be violent, it's going to kill cells. And doctors learned how to administer chemotherapy in a good number of years. I vividly remember my early experience at Memorial Hospital when we were injecting cyclophosphamide. We were all around the bed of the patient, waiting for the entire explosion of the human body. And this fortunately did not happen. Now I will show you in a moment how we can handle with cyclophosphamide in very high doses, one of the safest drugs. But still vomiting, hair loss, are bad images from the chemotherapy point of view. Are we really dealing with tremendous incidence of catastrophic side effects? The answer is no. What counts are not the acute side effects, because vomiting in the vast majority of patients can now be controlled with new drugs. The loss of hair unfortunately remains an unpleasant side effect, but it's not going to last forever in an adjuvant situation, so we are going to administer chemotherapy for about from 4 to 6, maximum 8 months. And it's totally reversible. There are more subtle and important side effects, such as the incidence of a second malignancy. From this point of view, melphalan, the first drug used in modern chemotherapy, was more dangerous than cyclophosphamide, particularly if we give chemotherapy as it was given for more than 12 months. Then the dose of chemotherapy is important. The extent of radiation therapy along with the dose, or the combination of alkylating agents with radiation therapy. So how high is this risk? Maybe as low as 1% or as high as 10%. It depends what type of treatment has been delivered. Now the treatments delivered today, such as CMF, for 6 months, the risk is very small. It's less than 1%. In our large series, will be produced early next year, hopefully at the ASCO meeting. These findings do remain important just to confirm that the risk does exist, but is so little that it's not terribly important for patients as well as clinicians. There are other side effects which we should take into consideration. For instance, the cardiac effects. Radiation therapy delivered after conservative surgery to the left breast may be potentially dangerous to the heart. So the myocardium is invested by the radiation beam, and you need a skillful radiation therapist to avoid most of the radiation therapy to the myocardium. If you use an anthracycline such as adriamycin or epirubicin, and treatment is delivered to the left breast, then there may be some side effects which we should take into consideration, count, and deliver the objective result. We have reviewed our own large series of patients, and the cardiac effects in terms of cardiotoxicity were 4 out of 780 patients, equal to 0.5%. Nothing frightening. There was a myocardial infarction, not necessarily related to either radiation therapy or chemotherapy. There were abnormal ST2T tract abnormalities, 4.4%. This is not fatal. You give these are electrocardiographic changes.
They are prominent when you give radiation, when we give radiation therapy to the left breast, 11.3%. When radiation therapy was combined with adjuvant CMF, 3.2%. When this was combined with adriamycin, 15.6%. So most of the toxicity to the heart is coming from radiation therapy. And if we had a drug such as adriamycin, we can slightly increase the risk of cardiac effect. I like to stress that the side effects improved in the evaluable patients in 92% of women. So this is also very much important. They also, the cardiac effects are related to treatment, as I mentioned before, and age. So in no adjuvant treatment in the small series we examined during that period of time, they were measurable in 11% of the patients. When CMF was given 10%, when adriamycin and CMF were delivered 12.8%, no breast irradiation, 6.4%, left breast irradiation, 17.7%. When patients were older than 55, we had 19.9%. So altogether, some cardiac effects do exist. Only two of our 790 patients died because of cardiac toxicity. That was the classical cardiomyopathy. Otherwise, altogether, we made percentages, but there is nothing frightening. We simply have to pay attention to the delivery of adriamycin in concomitance or in sequence with radiation therapy to the left. A few words about new studies. I mentioned before the importance of the dose. Now, clinical investigators went that far to give high-dose chemotherapy with autologous bone marrow transplantation. In advanced breast cancer, by advanced I mean metastatic disease, measurable by palpation or x-rays, the bone marrow transplantation turned out to be not terribly effective. There is an increased frequency of so-called complete remission, but they do not last very long, actually not longer than those achieved by giving chemotherapy in the conventional way. But in an adjuvant situation, we can probably exploit much better from high-dose chemotherapy. So our study, as well as concomitant studies being carried out in the United States, the objective was to evaluate the activity and applicability of high-dose sequential chemotherapy with circulating progenitor cell support. So we started a study which was prospective, not randomized, for the simple reason that we knew already what was the terrible prognosis of women having 10 or more than 10 positive axillary nodes. Practically, we can cure with local regional treatment only approximately 10 to 15% of the patients. The modalities utilized to reduce the hematological toxicity from these astronomically high doses were the use of growth factors following cyclophosphamide given at 7 grams per meter square. This drug does not destroy the stem cells. From this point of view, there is a rebound following the dose of cyclophosphamide, and we can collect the circulating progenitor cells. And from this point of view, we can definitely protect the patients. In other words, this is a rather complicated or complex slide for those who are not initiated. I will not spend too many words. Now, without hematopoietic growth factors, or with hematopoietic growth factors, there is always a leukopenia, a fall in white blood cells. But the time is prolonged compared to the leukopenia, which is going to last probably a couple of days. During those days, we do have to protect the patient. Also, the platelet fall is very important, but when utilized the PL3 or plus the GM-CSF, a combination of two hematopoietic growth factors, we had not the fall or severe fall in the platelets. So what we have done in practice, we started surgery. 30 days later, we delivered cyclophosphamide. And then in sequence, you see the days, increased in methotrexate, cisplatinum, and then another alkylating agent, a very high dose, and local regional radiation therapy completed the study. And we reinfused the bone marrow circulating cells following the administration of the second alkylating agent. So you see that the median duration of chemotherapy altogether was 8 weeks, definitely shorter than the conventional adjuvant chemotherapy. Median length of admission following cyclophosphamide, methotrexate, the second alkylating agents, and overall 14 days, 5 days, 14 and 33. So altogether, if it is going to work, it's going to turn out to be much more simple, both simple, and shorter compared to the conventional type of chemotherapy. Now, number of platelet transfusion, 1. 0 to 3, red blood cell transfusion 7 from 2 to 14. Altogether, turned out to be very successful, and we had only one death or iatrogenic death due to an unexpected complication from one of the hematopoietic growth factors. Our results are only the 2-year results. We have included approximately 70 patients into this prospective non-randomized study. The early findings are very promising. This is the comparison of what we have done during the same period of time with adriamycin followed by CMF. So time will tell how much will remain up here, how much will come down, but so far so good. In other words, this high-dose chemotherapy with bone marrow support circulating progenitors is going to probably to remain. We shall see. We have to wait for a number of reasons, at least another 3 years before coming up with solid results. But we have already the impression that this high-dose chemotherapy is going to be better in given subsets compared to the conventional chemotherapy. So we found a relevant activity, excellent tolerability, short duration, median 8 weeks. And what we should do is to refine this data, incorporating new drugs, utilizing different growth factors or combinations, a number of growth factors, so we'll have to utilize more than one at a time, and try to do a randomized comparison of high-dose chemotherapy versus our own best conventional treatment, which remains for the time being adriamycin followed by CMF. Now, the last part, it will take a few minutes. I'm going to mention our most recent study, which includes the primary chemotherapy in breast cancer. Again, I like to remember, recollect that when I was a research fellow at Memorial Hospital, not 200 years ago, only 30 years ago. Chemotherapy was called a funeral service, so we were really the last one before the pathologist. And it's a great pleasure to be able to turn the wheel to the point that in given subsets, now chemotherapy can begin the entire treatment strategy. You have a list which you probably already read. List of malignancies where primary chemotherapy is delivered to avoid mutilating surgery. Many people want that from each study we improve the survival results. Reverend Kenny said wise words. He was mentioning, and I thank him very much, the frustration from investigation. It takes years, decades before improving 5%. But at least we can improve quality of life. Now, we can avoid mutilating surgery in breast cancer or pharyngeal cancer. we stopped amputating patients just because with chemotherapy we can shrink the malignancy to the point that the surgeons can perform optimal surgery without disfiguring the patients. Now let's talk about breast cancer very quickly. This was a locally advanced breast cancer being treated in Milano as early as 1972 with an adriamycin-containing regimen followed by radiation therapy or surgery. This is a large series of patients. We learned a few things. If the tumor mass was 5 or less than 5 centimeters in diameter, in spite the stage was stage 3, we achieved reasonably good results at 10 years. When the same tumor with the same classification, stage 3, was measuring more than 10 centimeters in diameter, no one of these patients survived. And there was something, as usual, in between, measuring from 5 to 10 centimeters in diameter. If we make the attempt to do some calculations in terms of cell numbers, the tumor cell burden for a cancer measuring slightly more than 3 centimeters in diameter up to 10 centimeters in diameter, the tumor cell burden ranges from 10 to 11, 10 to the 12. If we deliver optimal primary chemotherapy, this tumor cell burden can be brought down to 10 to the 9 to 10 to the 8. 10 to the 8, the tumor is invisible, not palpable. At this point in time, surgery, conservative surgery, supplemented by postoperative irradiation, can really achieve local eradication in the vast majority of patients. But this is not the end of the battle, the end of the war. We have to come to this point, cure. From this point of view, we need so-called adjuvant chemotherapy or post-operative or post-irradiation chemotherapy. So the best in the future will be how to properly design the strategy with primary chemotherapy, local regional treatment, and adjuvant chemotherapy in the high-risk subsets. So about 4 years ago, the surgical staff of our institute accepted, they gave us the permission to try on 100 patients this primary chemotherapy. These kind of things cannot happen without a strong, loyal alliance with the surgeons. So there are surgeons, as I hope, in the room. Their loyalty is so important to make progress in the clinical research, particularly in this type of research. So they accepted to make the attempt to increase the frequency of breast-saving procedures in tumors measuring more than 3 centimeters in largest diameter. We also offered the possibility to decrease the frequency of local recurrences and make the attempt to further improve relapse-free and total survival. Eventually, after the first 100 patients, they extended the permission to go as high as 227 patients. And then we opened up a study. At that time, we started with CMF. All drugs given intravenously, we made it more simple. Or to utilize an adriamycin-containing regimen. This is always fluorouracil, adriamycin, and cyclophosphamide. Then we replaced adriamycin with its famous analog epirubicin. Then we replaced epirubicin with methoxantrone or nobentron. I wanted to prove to myself and to other people that was not by changing one drug within a triple drug regimen that we can make progress. But only data can convince people. The fifth set of patients was treated with adriamycin alone at the conventional maximum dose, 75 milligrams per meter squared. The whole thing was done within a few days. We made diagnosis and then we staged the patients, and then we started chemotherapy with the various drug regimens I mentioned before, with CMF or FAC. We gave either 3 or 4 cycles to see which was the optimal dose regimen. At that time, 2.5 years ago. At surgery, I went down myself for practically all the interventions and measured the tumor with the surgeons. That was objectively measured in less than 3 centimeters in diameter, a conservative type of surgery called, in Italy at least, quadrantectomy, was performed. Otherwise, we perform mastectomy. I don't want to make the whole thing too complex. This was the primary tumor size measured in centimeters, from 3 to 4 centimeters, 50% of the patients. Less than 3 centimeters in diameter at that time in Italy, all patients underwent modified radical mastectomy. But then I discovered that modified radical mastectomy was made all over the world, starting from the United States. Now things year by year are getting a little bit different. From 4.1 to 5%, 32%, 18% of these patients had a primary tumor measuring more than 5 centimeters in diameter. Clinical results by palpation and mammography were very good. 78% of the patients had either complete or partial response, more than 50%. In 15 additional patients, the partial response was minimal but sizable enough to perform surgery, conservative surgery. This is too complicated, but it tells you that there was no difference between CMF and FAC, FAC or FEC, whether we had Noventron or Adriamycin alone. So one potent, very potent, single-agent chemotherapy could achieve the same results in terms of tumor shrinkage as very effective, very established three-drug regimen. Now, there was a difference between 3 or 4 cycles of CMF or 3 or 4 cycles of FAC. We were determined to give the maximum tolerable dose, or in other words, to be very faithful as much as we could to the law of dose intensity. So you see that the number of treatment cycles in terms of dose intensity with all the drugs, that was very high. We practically gave to all the patients, or to vast majority of patients, a dose which was close to 100% of the planned dose, whether we gave either 3 or 4 cycles. Again, this is rather complex slide, but it tells you that in terms of tolerance, which is very good for the patients, the Noventron-containing regimen was the best. In terms of vomiting, only 13% of the patients. If you give Adriamycin-containing regimen, the vomiting is ranging from 32 to 33%. Adriamycin, rather high dose alone, 58%. Also, the hair loss, which is important for the patient, not necessarily for clinicians, but for the patient, is very important. Noventron-containing regimen, 6%. Adriamycin-containing regimen or epirubicin, 100%. Adriamycin alone, 97%. What is more subtle but very important, the Noventron-containing regimen was the most myelosuppressive combination utilized. 27% of these patients had a rather severe leukopenia. And this may turn out to be very important because unless these type of treatments are delivered by rather well-experienced medical oncologists, all other doctors will have tendency to lower the percentage of drug being delivered. So if we drop the dose level, that is going to be very important for the patient. In other words, low-dose chemotherapy, as I already mentioned, is not going to function very much. This is the key slide. You have the conservative surgery of quadrantectomy on the right side, and on the left side you have the tumor, initial tumor diameter from 3 to 4%. 93% of these patients had tumor measuring less than 3 centimeters in diameter at surgery. 97% of these patients benefited from quadrantectomy. from 4.1 to 5, less than 3 centimeters in diameter, 79%, 92% of the patients have conservative surgery. For more than 5 centimeters in diameter, this was feasible only in 73%. I said only, but to me it looks like a great result considering that all these patients would have practically the Olsted radical mastectomy. You see that complete tumor remission or disappearance, zero, not visible, not palpable, was seen in a number of patients. And pathologic complete remission for the time being remains 4% in our own experience. When we measure the findings in terms of survival, the two-year results were 93%, which was very satisfactory. As I mentioned before, we need time to be more reliable in terms of survival results. But for the time being, we can summarize the findings as follows. 3 cycles of full-dose primary chemotherapy can safely induce high tumor shrinkage, allowing to substitute conservative for mutilating surgery. And this, to me, is the best we can offer for the time being to our lady patients in terms of quality of life. From the medical point of view, the response rate was unrelated to age, so chemotherapy was equally effective in younger women and older women, menopause, laboring index, ploidy, and type of drug combination. If the tumor was measuring from 3 to 5 centimeters in diameter, conservative surgery was feasible in 91% of the patients. For those with more than 5 centimeters in diameter, this was 73%. Local recurrence was 3%, which was the lowest available in the medical literature. Again, I would like to wait a little longer, but it's not going to be dramatically increased. And of course, final treatment outcome remains to be fully evaluated. Now let us make a general conclusion. In my own opinion, considering the heterogeneity of the audience, in my own opinion, the main contribution of medical oncology at this point in time in terms of primary treatment of breast cancer are the emphasis on the concept that the disease is often systemic in nature. Surgeons honestly always believed that what they could resect was the end of the cure, or the end of the treatment, because potentially all patients were cured. They did not pay too much attention up to about 20 years ago of the classical prognostic factors. Medical oncology also contributed on the emphasis on multidisciplinary approach. Primary treatment should no longer be confined to the operative theater. That does not mean the surgeons are going to be useless, don't get me wrong. Also was the importance of quantitative aspects of clinical reasoning and decision making. Importance of tumor heterogeneity, drug dose intensity, and primary drug resistance. Last but not least, the formulation of new hypotheses for biological mechanisms. So these are important concepts for the future. What is expected of future medical oncologists? My own opinion, to consolidate and refine clinical skills. We cannot make a discovery once a month, as the newspaper people do expect. But refinements are very much important. To focus on prevention and quality of life besides treatment. To participate in clinical trials. And to improve patient-physician relationship. This is a very important topic. It would need another hour, but I'm going to stop right here. The patient-physician relationship, starting from how to explain the diagnosis, how to explain the potential treatments, and also the failures are something very important which the doctor should cultivate and grow in the next few years. So the evolution of systemic therapy in resectable breast cancer can be summarized as follows. We started 20 years ago with adjuvant single-agent chemotherapy in node-positive breast cancer, adjuvant combination chemotherapy or polychemotherapy in the same prognostic subset. Then a number of studies was set up trying to define the optimal duration of treatment, and then adjuvant endocrine therapy, namely tamoxifen, was shown to be of some benefit. Then we try adjuvant treatment, either chemotherapy or hormonal therapy, node-negative breast cancer. We are now trying to successfully combine sequentially chemotherapy first, followed by endocrine treatment. And last but not least, primary or neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Almost everything we have done over the past quarter of a century comes out from clinical trials. So clinical trials are very important, are the only tool to prove that something can really be effective or not effective. Not that we have to randomize every single patient in the earth. However, it is mandatory that doctors will participate in good programs of clinical research because medically and socially the treatment of choice comes from this type of clinical research. But research should be sound, otherwise we shall simply repeat a number of trials and data becomes boring and totally useless, and the cost of money of research will increase tremendously. And this is not going to help the creativity of doctors. So as a last slide, I mentioned what the French premier Georges Clemenceau said about the generals of the First World War in 1918 because of the useless butchery on the battlefields just to conquer a few meters or a few yards. The war is too a serious affair to be left only in the hands of generals. I adapted this famous sentence. The war against cancer is too an important affair to be left only in the hands of a self-defined investigators. And unfortunately, we have too many around. Thank you very much for your patient attention.
Thank you, Dr. Bonadonna. Are there any questions for Dr. Bonadonna? Do you have questions?
Is she mentioning the prevention trial with tamoxifen? That's very important. Apparently, we are unable to cure everyone.
And as I mentioned before, only refinements in strategic approaches are going to bring about better results. So if properly designed, as in this country, as far as I know, the prevention trial with the tamoxifen is going to be an important operation in general. I'm a little afraid, as Dr. Fisher himself, who is the leader of the group, said several times, if we, lay people from this point of view, overemphasize the importance of this trial, every single woman will have tendency to go either to the pharmacy or to her own doctor and swallow the tamoxifen, which would be fine in general, if we would be a little more sure, just a little more sure, that tamoxifen is, prolonged administration of tamoxifen, is going to be successful and devoid of certain side effects. So we are on the right side. Most probably tamoxifen is effective. Most probably is devoid of long-term side effects. But we are not sure. We have tendency to think in a certain way, come to precipitously to conclusion and let the panacea invade the entire field of medicine. This is not so good because not that patient we have tendency to make the transfer from tamoxifen to the heart surgery because patients will have the tendency to treat themselves. And to be objective is one of the cardinal law in medicine. But in a few words, the tamoxifen study is something very important. Yes. But wait a minute. I'm a doctor, but I'm not supposed to convince my wife. She is going to be convinced by herself. I'm a strong supporter. The role of the doctor is to inform the patient, not necessarily to tell the truth or the entire truth, but to inform the patient so my wife or my daughter will come to their own decision. You talk a little loud. Unfortunately, I had a slide. I thought I was talking for too long. Our own conclusion is the following. We give primary chemotherapy, for instance, breast conserving surgery. In high-risk patients, we add additional chemotherapy or adjuvant chemotherapy. Radiation therapy concludes the entire treatment strategy. I know that in this country, a good friend of mine, by the way, came up with different results. So there is a lot of debate in this country how to utilize post-operative radiation therapy. We went over to our own thousands and thousands of data. There is not a single recurrence within the first 6 months. So I wouldn't be frightened by delaying post-operative radiation for 6 months. Again, breast cancer or any malignancy is not going to run that fast. That's number one. Number two, because of the callus tradition, if you have a leukopenia, which may happen in approximately 15 to 17% of the patients, Dr. Raymond Weiss came to our institute, he's in the room a few years ago, and we came up with the conclusion that there is a competition between the two modalities, chemotherapy and radiation therapy. And in approximately 15 to 20% of the patients, there is some leukopenia because of the addition of radiation therapy to chemotherapy. Now, because of the tradition, you stop chemotherapy and you keep going with radiation therapy. Which one is most important? I'm afraid chemotherapy, because you can always control the disease within the breast. Actually, cancer of the breast is not a disease of the breast, but is the disease outside of the breast. Patients die not because we don't control the local disease. Patients die because we are unable at times to control distant disease. So at least in Milano, but we are gaining more ground, we conclude the treatment with radiation therapy. We don't feel, on the basis of large data, that we should start postoperative irradiation right away. Oh, please, you don't have to stand up. Just raise a little bit your voice. That's all I need. We are studying Taxol ourselves, phase one, phase two, and so on. We are interested in the drug. We are not over-enthusiastic. It does work. It will take probably more than 2 years. We badly need new drugs with different mechanisms of action. But before Taxol or similar kind of drugs will be conventionally given or taking part to the armamentarium of a medical oncologist, it will take more than 2 years. First of all, you have to prove, not that the drug is active, we know that the drug is active, but how you place it, is that going to take the place of adriamycin or to replace fluorouracil plus cyclophosphamide and methotrexate? I wouldn't know. In other words, we have to set up a number of prospective studies to find out which is going to be the optimal sequence. I know that patients through the media would jump on the Taxol. If you change the name of the drug, they would jump on the other one just because they have different perspective. So Taxol is active, but how to use it in a proper way to come up with more useful results for the patient, not with more papers for research physicians, it will take probably more than 2 years. I understood the problem. You know, data are changing concepts, and concepts are changing data. I don't want to sound too philosophical, but this is the way. Now, we all matured in terms of experience. We research physicians, general practitioners, as well as the patients. What was not conceivable 20 years ago, now it can be conceived. If we find the high-risk subset, we must use adriamycin. We should be a little more confident in defining those subsets. Little by little, you know, the data will make people more mature. Now we know that we can deliver, for instance, 7 grams per meter square of cyclophosphamide without hurting irreversibly the bone marrow. We now know that we can make our data more interesting and useful for the patient by utilizing adriamycin. It's only a matter of time, but provided we will know a little more about the high-risk subsets with node negative, the node negative per se will become obsolete. We shall be able probably to define the future, regardless of the positive or negative nodes, which are going to be the high-risk subsets. In this case, adriamycin will be utilized. Did you hear the questions?
Repeat your question again.
Can you repeat it a little louder, please? If we have a high number of nodes, radiation therapy is not given to the axilla any longer. For the past 25 years, we dropped or we convinced the radiation therapists not to irradiate the axilla. Good surgeons can clear the axilla very well, the vast majority of patients. And postoperative irradiation is now being utilized only because of the multicentricity of breast cancer and because of the conservative surgery. So that's the only conventional, as of today, indication of postoperative irradiation. It's supposed to become available to everyone. I remember some 20, 25 years ago that open heart surgery was only done in South Africa and in a couple of centers such as Stanford. I heard just by entering the door that you have open heart surgery. This is a reputable large hospital, but you don't need a 25-story building to make progress in medicine. Again, we are trying to simulate a number of situations in our own ongoing studies in such a way that we keep the patients within the laminar flow rooms, but we open up the doors, we send the patients home, just nothing happens. We can easily predict when the white blood cells will drop. So we seal the patients only for 2 to 4 days. The rest can be performed outside. Again, we need probably a larger number of cycles than those available to come up with firm data. The trouble is that if we are going to be very successful, we are going to expand these indications and all together, but, you know, little by little. Let's prove first that it's very useful and very safe. Those two options seem to be available. Then I don't see that the size of the hospital is going to be a barrier. The hospital will be further equipped with new tools, new concepts, and of course, better results. Takes a little longer to make these firm statements.
It's my pleasure to call to the podium Dr. William D. Dolan.
I just received my orders. I'm to present this to you. What it is, you'll have to find out by opening. We do appreciate you coming. It was excellent talking. We're honored by having you here.
Thank you very much.
Get your picture taken now because they want to be sure that they gave you something.
So who's going to give it?
Just look at it. Don't look at it.
That's safe and innocent. Okay?
I know what this is. Put that in your
pocket. Okay. Thanks a lot.
I don't know if you can smell the food, but my stomach's been grinding here, so we're not going to keep you any longer. I just want to say thank you for myself. Thank you, Dr. Dolan, for being. And I would like to especially thank Judy Fox, Kathy Hayes, and Lee McGuire, who have helped us immeasurably putting this evening on. And please all join us out here for some refreshments. And I hope we're all here next year to have you back again. Thank you very much.